While we prepare for the next talk, I'll present our speaker, who is mostly known for people as the third slide, probably.
What?
The third slide. We have dark matter, but this is Moti Milgrom. He's working here in the Weizmann Institute for many years. And I don't think I'm mistaken by saying that he's the proposes a different view, a very different view of dark matter,
of non-dark matter,
of the postulation of dark matter, as the misunderstanding of gravitation. I'll let him present it.
Indeed, it has to be realized that all that we just heard is not really evidence for dark matter. Okay? It is evidence that something is very wrong with our understanding of all those systems that were described. And the procedure that one follows is to apply standard dynamics, be it Newtonian dynamics or general relativity, to deduce masses in all those systems that you heard. And what one finds are huge discrepancies between what one deduces and what one sees directly in the form of baryons, as we say. Okay, these discrepancies may be attributed to dark matter, if one wishes, but there is also the possibility that the laws that we apply break down in the realm of those of galaxies, clusters of galaxies, and the universe at large. Indeed, I should say that Danny failed to mention in his very first transparency that there was another planetary anomaly, which was the perihelion shift of Mercury, which was at first attributed to missing matter in the form of dark planets, but in the end turned out to harbinger the breakdown of Newtonian dynamics, and it was due indeed to modified gravity. Okay, so with this in mind, I want to present a particular modification of dynamics that I've been following for many years. It is 30 years now, in fact. It is called MOND, for Modified Newtonian Dynamics. This was the original acronym, but now it has attained a much wider sense. For example, it is it applies to relativistic systems and so on and forth. So this is a very brief synopsis of what I'm going to talk about. MOND hinges on accelerations, namely, it builds on the fact that accelerations in galactic systems and the universe at large are much, much, many orders of magnitude smaller than what you find in the solar system, and in the lab, of course. And so it might be that our dynamics, well-loved dynamics that we know so well and that is tested so well in the solar system and the lab, breaks down in this limit of very small accelerations. It turns out to work very well in predicting many properties in galaxies. We will see that. It leaves a discrepancy in galaxy clusters in the sense that it does correct, or it does reduce the necessary mass in galaxy clusters by a factor of 3 or 4. So of the original discrepancy that we just heard about, of about 8 to 10, it still leaves a discrepancy, a persistent discrepancy and systematic discrepancy in most clusters of a factor of about 2. So you need only as much additional matter in clusters as you see directly, but this could easily be due to rather mundane forms. I'm not sure I'll have time to discuss this. And in fact, the bullet cluster is part of this conundrum, and in fact, it is explained by the same in the same way. So indeed, I don't see the bullet cluster as a, certainly not as a mortal problem for such such modified gravity ideas. I may not have time to discuss this penultimate point, which is that just from the phenomenology of MOND and from the value of the relevant constant that appear, we can already see that MOND is tightly connected with cosmology in some way. There are some mysterious coincidences that tell us that MOND perhaps is an effective theory that has to do with the universe at large and a way in which the universe at large enters local dynamics in galaxies. I will not speak about theories, but there do exist several full-fledged theories of gravity. By full-fledged, I mean theories that are on a par with Newtonian dynamics or with relativity, that you can, in principle, use to calculate everything. They are derived from actions. They are fully legitimate theories, but I will restrict myself today to speaking about phenomenology. This is still the raison d'etre of MOND, and I think it is the point that has to be emphasized. But we have to remember that there are theories that... So the basic tenets, if you want just to go home and remember what MOND is, it's very simple. You introduce into physics a new constant with the dimensions of acceleration. We call it A naught. And A naught has several roles in the theory. So for one, it marks the boundary, the validity boundary of the, let's call it classical dynamics in this regard, in the sense that when accelerations in the system are much larger than A naught, you expect to restore standard dynamics. So formally, if you have a theory, let's say I wrote a theory, a MOND theory, and it has A naught in it, if I formally take the limit A0 goes to zero, it's like a correspondence principle in quantum mechanics, like taking H bar to zero, I expect to get standard dynamics back. So this is one limit, but the crux of the theory is what happens in the opposite limit, namely when accelerations are, let's say, much smaller than A naught, or formally you can take A naught to infinity in a theory. It turns out formally that at the same time you have to take g of Newton to zero and keep g times a zero fixed. Okay, then the requirement is that the theory becomes scale invariant. That's all. So we base this MOND idea on a symmetry. Scale invariance means that if you multiply all degrees of freedom with dimension of time and length by the same factor, you get the same. You still get a solution of the theory. Okay, so more specifically, suppose you consider one system with its own dynamics, let's say self-gravitating system like a galaxy. And then you look at another system that's made up, this is just a scale-up version of the first one, where you increase all distances by the same factor and all the relevant times by that same factor, then you get another solution of the system. That is the statement of the scale invariance. Now, Newtonian dynamics is not scale invariant. In Newtonian dynamics, gravitational forces scale like 1/2 length square, but accelerations, okay, d square r dt square, scale like 1/2 lambda, okay, r over t square. Remember, we multiply r and t by the same factor. So Newtonian dynamics is not scale invariant. You can make it, not make it, but modify it to get a theory that is scale invariant in two sort of extreme ways. One way is to say that instead of acceleration being proportional to force, the square of the acceleration is proportional to force. And then the right-hand side goes like 1/2 lambda square when you scale, and so does the left-hand side. Or you can, so this would give you what we call modified inertia theories, was the initial starting point of MOND. So you want to modify the law of inertia. Or you can modify the law of gravity by taking, say, non-relativistic gravity in this case, to go like 1/r, but it also has to... be proportional to square root of m instead of m itself. Anyway, these are the caricatures of two avenues which you can follow in modified gravity to get a scale invariant theory in the low acceleration regime. And then all that I will say from now on can actually be derived with some slight additional but very reasonable assumption just based on this basic tenet. So I will not even use a theory. So immediately, I will list in a minute, I will list some, like you have those basic tenets, you build a theory on them, a theory that embodies these tenets, and then with this theory, in principle, you can calculate everything, motion in galaxies and so on. But it, as is always the case, it's useful to distill or summarize some laws that you can look at and test, even without a detailed calculation. So indeed, there are such laws. As I already indicated, there are practically based on only the basic tenets. If you interpret them in terms of dark matter, then some of these laws can be interpreted as properties of the dark matter alone. So they tell you something, well, if you believe in dark matter, MOND tells you that when you go and test and map dark matter halos, they will have this or that property. Some of these pertain to baryonic properties. So just look at the baryons and you should see these laws there. And some pertain to connections between the two components, putative components. And another point to remember is that quite a few of them revolve around A naught, so in different roles, and you can determine A naught from them. And of course, the fact is that A naught as determined from these independent laws is the same or consistently the same. So I like to liken it, in quantum mechanics, you have many phenomena in which H bar appears, starting historically from black body radiation, from the photoelectric effect, the Bohr atom, quantum Hall effect, superconductivity, and so on. Phenomenologically, the disappearance of H bar are not connected. They are all sort of connected and unified by the presence of an underlying theory, which is quantum mechanics. And I want to argue here that if you just look at the phenomenology, galactic phenomenology shows very clearly the appearance of a constant A naught in many roles. And when you determine it from this phenomenon, A naught turns out to be the same. And that, I think, is telling us that there is some underlying theory behind it. So this is just a list of some of these laws. I will discuss only very few of them. So the first one, I said from scale invariant, it immediately follows that the rotational speed in a galaxy should become constant asymptotically. We saw quite a few examples in Dan's talk, right? So scale invariant just tell you, take a circular orbit, multiply the radius by a given factor, multiply the time, the orbital time, by the same factor, and you get, it is the correct solution for the new orbit. But if you do that, you get the same velocity, of course. Like the radius and time are multiplied by the same. So it's a modified Kepler's law. Instead of orbital time going r to the minus 3 half, r to the 3 halves, orbital time goes like r in this case, and rotation curves are flat. Another thing that scale invariance tells you is that in this MOND theory, we have A naught appearing and we have G appearing. But for a theory to be scale invariant, A naught and G cannot appear separately because they have the wrong dimensions. Okay, in a scale invariant theory, you can only have constants appearing whose dimensions are such that they are independent of a scaling of time and length by the same factor. So A naught and G do not have this property, but A naught times G does. And so in the what we call the deep MOND limit, namely describing systems whose accelerations are much smaller than A naught everywhere, only the constants A naught times G appear. And this implies that, for example, that asymptotic velocity that I mentioned before around any galaxy must be of this form. Okay, so it must depend on the mass and the GA in this form. So there's immediately a prediction, not only that the velocity should become constant at larger, but it is determined by the mass of the baryons. Now, I marked here that this is a property that if you believe in dark matter, you'll attribute to the halo, because at large distance, large radii, the halo by far dominates the baryons. And so the fact that the asymptotic speed is constant is somehow reflects some property of the halo. The second property, I say light bending is similar. This is a connection between halo and baryons, because it tells you that this asymptotic velocity that's purportedly determined by the halo should depend only on the mass of the baryons that are in the middle. Okay, it's a very small amount of baryons in the middle. If you believe in dark matter, then in galaxies, the ratio of dark matter to baryons, as deduced, for example, from weak lensing to large distances, we know that rotation curves actually stay flat to maybe 100, 200 kiloparsecs. And from that, you deduce a ratio that is maybe 10 times the cosmic ratio. namely not 6 to 1 dark matter to baryons, but maybe 100 to 1 or 50 to 1. So it's much larger. And yet it turns out that the small amount of baryons at the center determines the asymptotic speed. And so on. There's a list of properties. And now to some data. So this describes the second prediction that I just mentioned, namely the dependence of the... So what people did here, they took many galaxies, they looked at the rotation curve, they measured the asymptotic rotation curve. Of course, I'll show you many rotation curves later. So you take the asymptotic velocity on the rotation curve plotted here, and deduce baryonic mass, not dark matter, not dynamical mass, the baryonic mass. And this is the plot you get over quite a few orders of magnitude in mass. And this is the prediction of MOND. This was the V square, V to the fourth going like M, and with the value of A naught, that's okay, determined from other. This is another version of the same plot. This is, if you want, I can explain to you later what this is, but it is what you would expect from the dark matter, from cold dark matter picture, if galaxies retain the cosmic baryon fraction. So you see that it is off by a factor of 10, so that is why dark matter people introduced the notion of feedback, namely that galaxies actually ejected most of their baryons over their lifetime, so instead of sitting on this line, galaxies went to this, but then why do they go to a line and not actually fill all this region is a mystery. But anyway, so this is one. This plot is just to show that, in fact, the scatter about the predicted line is consistent with zero intrinsic scattering. When you compare it with the Gaussian, the histogram is the actual scatter. The Gaussian is what you expect if only measurement errors produce the scatter, and indeed they agree. So it's consistent with there being no intrinsic scatter. Okay, an even stronger prediction is, remember, let's say we now look not just at the asymptotic velocity on a disk rotational speed, but overall radii. And let us plot the measured acceleration. So you measure some acceleration at a given radius in a given galaxy, which is just the measured v squared divided by r. And you compare it with the acceleration predicted by Newtonian dynamics using just the distribution of baryonic matter. And the ratio of the two accelerations is here defined as the mass discrepancy. Because if interpreted in terms of dark matter, it actually gives you the total dark matter, the total mass, dynamical mass enclosed within R divided by the baryonic mass. So MOND predicts that, let's say we write the measured acceleration as a function of the Newtonically calculated acceleration. So we can always, just on dimensional grounds, write it like this, Gn to give it the right dimension, and some function of the ratio of Gn over A naught in MOND. Now, in the limit of, we said that when accelerations are much larger than A naught, namely the argument of this function nu becomes very large, you want nu to go to 1 so as to restore standard dynamics. In the opposite limit, scale invariance dictates that nu should go like y to the minus 1/2. Okay, so MOND predicts that if you plot g versus gn, both measurable, most measured, you will get some function that has these two asymptotic forms. Okay, so as an exercise, people also plotted this mass discrepancy that I just defined, which is measured, okay? It is measured radius by radius in many spiral galaxies, in many disk galaxies. And then when it was plotted versus the radius, you find no correlation. So that just reflects the fact that the mass discrepancy is not correlated with size, as one sometimes hears. We know, independent of this, that there are small galaxies with large mass discrepancies. We heard about dwarfs. And there are much larger galaxies with smaller mass discrepancies and so on. So there's no correlation of the mass discrepancy with size, but there is a very sharp correlation with acceleration. So here the discrepancy is plotted versus the Newtonian acceleration. And the two predicted asymptotic behaviors are marked here in blue, which is just one, no discrepancy, predicted to apply at high accelerations, and in red is the scale invariant prediction for low accelerations. Okay, so you see that except for this region where you have to interpolate, of course, between the two regimes, first of all, what you learn from this plot, that indeed there is very sharp, very strong correlation of mass discrepancy with acceleration, that there is A naught here, in fact, appear in several ways. So for example, A naught would be the value here where sort of you go from one asymptotic behavior to the other. And it's totally unrelated to the A naught that is deduced from the previous graph, because that previous graph made use of just asymptotic speed at very low acceleration. This is the role of A naught as a transition. So it's completely different. I could construct families of galaxies with dark matter that will satisfy any of those predicted laws, any subset, and will not satisfy the others. So in the framework of dark matter, these laws are completely independent. I mean, none of them follow from the others. So if you claim that you can get them in dark matter and you've shown that you have one or two or three of them, you still have to show that you have the others. They don't actually follow. A naught also appears here in the normalization of this scale. Okay, so this is a similar plot for, okay, so that one, you may have read here that it's based on 73 disk galaxies, all that these people had at the time, and only points with measurement errors less than 5%. They are all disk galaxies. When you repeat the same exercise for a spherical system, dwarf galaxies, elliptical galaxies, and so on, these are not actually data points, but they, because the scatter is much larger, so it is a bin data, but you see the same effect. What's plotted here is somewhat different. It's the measured acceleration versus the Newtonian acceleration, some measure. And you see again that, of course, for the same value of A naught, there is a break. Above it, there is agreement with the Newtonian prediction, and here there's a... But, of course, the flagship of MOND testing, so the things I showed you so far are some distillation, some summary of galaxy rotation curve data. Okay, they put together on the same graph. But now I want to show you some... many individual rotation curves, and this is really where most of the evidence for MOND lies. So what you see here, of course, is a measured rotation curve in the form of data points, and the Newtonian rotation curve, namely the rotation curve calculated just based on the distribution of visible baryonic matter. And the point that the curves that go through the data points are the predictions, the MOND predictions. And they are predictions. I mean, apart from some minor adjustments that are allowed, they are predictions, okay? They are unavoidable predictions. You have to realize this. The only caveat is that sometimes you have to use a mass to light ratio to convert stellar mass to light. But even this is a very weak constraint. For example, in many cases, galaxies are dominated by gas, okay, and then the stars do not contribute much, and then the stellar mass to light ratio doesn't even matter much. So then you have a parameterless prediction. Okay, for example, in this case, this is a low surface density gas-dominated galaxy, and the same here. And so, okay, so I'll just very quickly. And there have been many such studies with many samples of galaxies. So what I show you is just a collation of, you know, coming from different analyses, just to show you that there are many galaxies that have been looked at, some with all sorts of properties. One thing to notice, for example, is that in some cases you actually have features on the rotation curve, and those features simply appear because the baryonic mass distribution has some feature. Okay, so when MOND preserves all the details of the rotation curve because it is based only on the baryonic distribution. Okay, but if you add a dark matter halo, it tends to wash out these features. Okay, indeed, for example, the best dark matter halo fit for this galaxy does not follow the. I mean, you can see in this galaxy, this is the Newtonian curve. So you see there's a factor of 2.5 in velocity between what's seen and what's predicted. Translated into mass, it is about a factor of 5 or 6. So in this region already, dark matter dominates by far, dominates the baryons. Okay, so it just cannot have such a feature in the distribution. And there are many galaxies. I mean, some of them. One aspect of galaxy dynamics that is extremely important to this issue of modified gravity versus dark matter are the so-called tidal dwarfs. And they are very little discussed, despite the fact that they are so crucial. Tidal dwarfs are formed in the following way. Two galaxies collide. They could just follow through the collision and not merge. And if one of them at least has gas in it, is a disk galaxy with gas, it forms a tidal tail. So on the left is a real observation. There are this galaxy and another one that's out of the frame here. They collided some 500 million years ago. And then a tidal tail, or a tidal ring in this case, is puffed up from the system. And after a few hundred million years, small galaxies form in this tidal tail. They just condense and collapse. And if you are lucky enough, you can look at them. In this case, three of the galaxies could be observed with high enough resolution to measure their rotation curves. And this is just a simulation of the same system to see that people understand what has been going on there. Okay. Now, why are these are so important? Because at least cold dark matter predicts the tidal dwarf should contain no dark matter. Okay, in the process of collision, dark matter that is cold, that is hot, I mean, in the sense, it's not in the sense of being cold dark matter, but hot in the sense that it doesn't, that, you know, unlike the gas, it appears in a halo, doesn't follow into this tidal tail. So the tidal tail is devoid of dark matter, and so the galaxies that form in it are devoid of dark matter. And yet, if you look at these measurements of the rotation curves, I'm not sure you can see it very well, you see that the points, the discourses are the data. So they're for the three galaxies here. And the inverted triangles are what you expect from Newtonian dynamics if you just use the mass that's observed in them. And you see that these galaxies do show mass discrepancies. So if you want dark matter, they'll have to contain dark matter, which is very problematic for cold dark matter, at least. Okay, and the squares are the predictions of MOND. So these systems are low acceleration. The acceleration in them are about a factor of 3 to 5 below A naught, and indeed you find mass discrepancies. Very quickly, two examples of elliptical galaxies with X-ray envelopes. So these are not rotation curves. Some, but it's very rare. Elliptical galaxies have extended envelopes of X-ray gas, which if assumed to be in hydrostatic equilibrium, you can measure the temperature and density profile in the gas envelope, determine the density profile, and from that determine the gravitational field. Or, in this case, interpret it as dynamical mass distribution. So what these people did, the gray band and also the open circles are the deduced masses in this elliptical dynamical masses, not the actual mass. So what's plotted is the mass enclosed within radius r as a function of r. Now, the galaxy itself can provide you only this much. So you see that while inside, this is a logarithmic scale, so well within the galaxy, the galaxy, the baryons, the stars that you see account well for the required gravitational field, but outside it falls short by a factor of about 10 in both cases. Okay, so this is a mass discrepancy again. So you would interpret it in terms of dark matter, but if you use the MOND prescription, you get the black squares without dark matter. So here is the case. I just have to say something. So these are dwarf spheroidals, predictions of MOND compared with the data, gravitational lensing, weak lensing, galaxy weak lensing. Okay. So the lines are the MOND predictions for two types of the blue galaxies are spiral galaxies and the red galaxies are elliptical red galaxies. And I do want to say something about clusters. So as I already mentioned in the introduction, MOND still leaves a remnant mass discrepancy in galaxies after it corrects. So you can see, for example, a plot of the dynamical mass in clusters versus the observed mass. If you deduce it with Newtonian dynamics, you get this offset, which is by a factor of 5 to 10, let us say. With MOND, you reduce it greatly because acceleration in the outskirts of clusters are low compared with A0. You reduce it greatly, but it still leaves a discrepancy of about a factor of 2. And this is the bullet cluster. Now, what I want to say here is that I don't know what this discrepancy is due to, but it is now much easier to explain it with mundane means, such as, for example, baryonic mass. Now, you have to realize that, it was mentioned that we think 4% of the universe is made of baryonic mass, but we have actually detected only a fraction of that. So there's also missing baryons. We know that about 60% of the baryons are still missing. We don't know where they are. So only a small fraction of them, if they are still residing cluster, could explain this remaining discrepancy. And add to that the fact that and this is a fact that we've known for many years for individual clusters since the early 90s. And if you accept this explanation, then the bullet cluster just comes out as a result. I mean, if you take two such individual clusters, let them collide, you get what you see in the bullet cluster. So despite all the noise that was made of the bullet cluster as proof of dark matter, it is not proof of dark matter. I mean, in the simplest meaning of the word. Okay. It's very interesting that A0 is of the order of C times H0. If you can define cosmologically significant accelerations, for example, speed of light divided by lifetime of the universe, speed of light times Hubble constant, the cosmological constant, somehow, numerically, it turns out that A0 is close to these values, and the CO is trying to explain this, and it probably is telling us something very deep about the origin of MOND and so on. No time to discuss it. And I leave you with the summary. Your kind of audience is really the last kind of audience that I would like to discourage from looking for dark matter, because I really want you to keep looking for dark matter, and it's very important for settling this issue. But still, I have to tell you that I don't think that the explanation of all this is due to dark matter. Thank you.
I think we have time for one, maybe two quick questions, because everybody's already...
There's a factor of 2 between the bending of light relativistically and the corpuscular view. MOND does not affect nanophysics, nothing to do.
It does, well, why not? It does. I mean, I did show you some results of gravitational lensing, and they do use this factor of 2.
No, so it uses the factor. And
no, but I have to tell you that relativistic MOND CO do predict this factor of 2 as well as
But can you say more about
this?
Because when I asked theories, the relativistic MOND theories, they said, oh, these are truly ugly and blah, 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 and don't work on the scale and so on. But then on the other hand, you say there's several theories and they work.
Okay, first of all, ugly. I don't want to judge by your ugliness. I mean, you could say the general relativity is ugly because it has 10 potentials and it's very, Newtonian gravity is much simpler. so let's not discuss ugliness. So the first relativistic MOND COE that actually did lensing correctly is called Davis by Bekenstein.
Right. But then there are several issues with that.
Right, there are. So it's not that I on my very first slide, I wrote, I think, that there are quite a few MOND COEs, but I don't think any of them is the final answer for different reasons. But there are COEs like bimetric MOND that also gives you the same factor of two, but has not been explored to this extent. And the truth of the matter is that we don't really know. So it may well be that none of the COEs that we work with today are the final COEs that give you everything. Okay, but at least they show that you do have, for many years it was the main objection level that MOND was that you don't have a relativistic COE. So at least that's a proof of concept. We show that you can construct relativistic COE. There's nothing in MOND that inherently contradict relativity, you can construct. Maybe these are not the correct COEs.
Did you ever, you didn't say anything about cosmology.
No, I only mentioned in the first slide that we are not yet, it should be emphasized, we are not yet in a state to do cosmology with MOND, okay, for different reasons. I mean,
but maybe with the relativistic theory, that's what you're trying to do, no?
Yes, but for some of the relativistic version, it has not been tried. Look, it's a very difficult question. I mean, it's unfortunately not so many people work on MOND on that method. So by all means, I mean, try some of these theories to see. It's not that they contradict cosmology as we know, and they do have elements that mimic the role of dark matter in cosmology. Of course they do. But the question was that they can actually produce all the details in cosmology, that is another matter, so we don't know yet. But to me, the way I look at it is this, look at all that MOND does, and it does a lot, and it does it very well. Indeed, there are things that it doesn't yet do, but to me, I look at what it does do, and for me, it is an indication that it is the correct direction, and now, yes, go ahead and develop it and try to find extensions that will do cosmology correctly. But you cannot ignore all this. I mean, I didn't want to denigrate dark matter, but dark matter doesn't get anywhere near predicting such rotation curves. Dark matter doesn't predict rotation curves. I mean, it is only, you need that much dark matter, so you go to the library of halos, and you find one with several parameters that fits what you see. Okay, so but it doesn't predict anything. So it is. Yeah.